So this is a sort of new idea we have. So what we wanted was a way to sort of let you know behind the scenes. So we give all these courses, like you see us answering issues, you see us like teaching here. But really, who are we and how did we get here? So my personal goal here was to sort of like demystify the kind of career we have so we can open up more possibilities for y'all that are listening to this course. Like, why would you want to consider working for someone like us instead of the other options? So I have some small questions prepared, and Thomas and I can sort of have a discussion. And I guess any other instructors can jump in at any time if they're interested. Yeah, so that's the idea. So if you have comments, I mean, please say so. So, Thomas, what's your background? Like, how did you start off your career?
I started initially studying bioinformatics, went into protein structure analysis and these kind of things. Then did a PhD in metabolic modeling with constraint-based models, linear programming, and so on. And before joining here, was a postdoc again on this metabolic modeling. And essentially, the whole time, I kind of had the impression, I'm not entirely sure what I'm doing. And what I enjoyed most was helping people with comparatively smaller tasks normally. So some technicians who had problems with their way or who had to enter stuff into Excel sheets all the whole time, which could simply be automated by a small script that I wrote them. Stuff where su supporting people with a toolbox that I was co-developing in metabolic modeling and these kind of things. So essentially, helping people was something that I enjoyed actually a lot more than the research itself. Partially because with research, it was always the you have to publish this, you have to make this publishable. There was a lot more, I would say, pressure in a way on getting results. And there was a lot less, for me, a lot less reward.
Like
Or
less
a lot
reward
less
in like
reward that I felt
the
where I had the impression that what I was doing was really something useful. There were examples where I noticed, okay, we actually can do something useful, but that was again where we were working with some groups where we had an interaction and we were to some extent helping them do something. So,
So is this like going outside the publication cycle or something like that? Like, or is that too broad?
To me, when I finished my last postdoc, I was like, okay, I liked what I was doing in general, but there were two things that I didn't really like. And one thing was the whole short-term contracts that were omnipresent in academia. So if I would have gotten a permanent postdoc position, that would have been happy with. And the other was this impression that a lot of the science that was out there or that was done in my field mainly got published in higher impact journals if the right names were on it, not necessarily because of the of whether the quality of the research was actually better. And this whole cycle was kind of not appealing. So after that last postdoc, I essentially said, "Yeah, I don't want
So,
to have this anymore."
yeah. So I guess that sort of answers my next question. What led you to transition to research support?
Yeah.
But then how did you actually make this transition? Like, when did you realize, oh, there's an option and I have the skills for it?
Actually, when did I notice? That was after, well, when we moved over to Finland. My wife originally started in Aalto as a researcher, and I wanted to stay at home with the kids. And shortly after we moved over, on well, actually not that shortly, there was the first time that, or I think it was the second RSE position that was advertised with Aalto. I did apply for that as well. In that round, didn't wasn't taken on, but essentially, yeah, the, this that was kind of the first time that I really noticed this RSE kind of position, because while I was still working as a postdoc, we did hire a bioinformatician at the time, which was also something where I thought, well, okay, there are a couple of things that essentially any biosciences lab should have, and one of them is probably bioinformatician, one of them is probably a biostatistician, and I hadn't ever heard of a research software engineer.
Yeah, so
So
what is research software engineer? I guess that's RSE.
well, to me, it's helping people with coding issues. Not with I need my Excel installed or something, but more I have code that I can't get to run on Triton for whatever reason. I can't get some libraries installed on the cluster. I've code that works but is terribly slow for whatever reason, and I well it's in a state that's either close to publishing or already published, but we would like to reuse it, and yeah, but we don't really have the time to go dig in and analyze that.
So is it sort of
These
like being the computational generalist that can do anything for people?
To some extent, yes.
Yeah,
Or
okay.
at least ha having the having a general overview of how to program, how to code, having probably a bit of a deeper knowledge on how to structure code so that it's usable, or more importantly, reusable. How to get a useful interface for some code that is otherwise very difficult to access. Yeah, these a lot of it is these kind of things that you code a lot, you code along, you do your stuff, and at some point you notice, oh, I might need to reuse this. Oh, this will be this would be a lot of work to make it actually reusable again, because it's so focused on one specific task. And the knowledge of how to either avoid this from the beginning, that is something I think that a research software engineer should at least well, learn during their career.
Is it like a programmer for a research group, sort of? Or,
Yes, to some extent. It's
Well, okay,
well,
maybe
a research
let's
software engineer, I would
go
say,
on.
is more about how to structure the code and how to get the code in a shape that is understandable than designing a most a designing well designing the solution to a problem.
Because I mean, I guess we don't do this as much at Aalto, but I've heard some RSEs, they might actually be doing this like solution designing or like, starting earlier, but I guess that's just how it is.
It's potentially just teaching a group the best practices of using GitHub, using version control, and these kind of things. That is also part of the RSE job.
So should we move on to the next question? So there's from HackMD, someone asked, Do you think that what you learned in academia can be reused outside in the real world? And what is that thing? Which I guess what is that thing means, what's the real world? Any comments on that? Also, I have a comment too that I could
I think
give.
that is a good question. The problem, I think a lot of stuff that you learn in academia can be reused. The problem is a lot of it will not. It could be, it will not. So it's more the more specialist knowledge that you have, the less likely it is that this particular special knowledge will actually be reused. Partially due to if you know one specific kind of let's take an experiment, some kind of experimental setup, it's very likely that whatever company you go in has a different setup, or at least to some extent different setup that you need to learn. What you can use is understanding how this setup works. So if you got the general knowledge on how is this set up and what are the different parts of it, that is something that you can reuse. So a lot of it comes down to you are with a good academic background, you're probably good at adapting to things. And yeah, that's I think what makes it different, or yeah, where stuff can be reused.
Once I was at a really great talk, this was like 2014, maybe. It was here at Aalto. I can't find any evidence of this talk, any of the material, anything like that. But it was, what can a PhD, what use does a PhD have in a company? And this was actually an amazing talk. It was something like, what do you do as a PhD? So it's things like you take a problem no one knows the answer to, and you do research, you study existing sources, and you figure out a solution, even if it means working on it for a very long time. You know how to write things in a clear way. You know how to give presentations. And these are, I mean, these are not obvious things. Like, this is something that is like
Yeah,
a very new, And
that's not your specialist knowledge. That's your general knowledge that you get by being in academia.
And I think that given people are always reinventing themselves anyway, then this is like not a bad thing to go sort of transitioning and learning different specialist knowledge and reapplying your generalist knowledge. There's a question here. How long did it take for you to get the hang of scientific computing?
Hang of scientific computing. I'm not sure if I already kind of have it. it this is how long does it take you to get the hang of computing in general? I think that I think there's the difference between I'm able to write a script that I'm able to write a script. And I'm able to structure code so that so that I can actually reuse parts of it at least. That is, I think, where I would draw the line between not getting the hang and getting the hang of it. This can be pretty quick. This can take quite some time, depending on your environment and essentially what teachers you have. I would count ask what is the hang of scientific computing?
I bet if you ask any one of us, we would say we're still getting the hang of it. Like we're still learning things. And that's sort of like maybe getting the hang of it is learning that you'll never know any everything, and you're just constantly able to learn new things as you need to.
For example, now, looking at the projects that we currently get, a lot of it is about web servers and web server development. And yeah, I essentially hadn't done any web server stuff before starting here. Mm-hmm. So is this scientific computing or is this not scientific computing? Mm-hmm. I think it is because it gives access to the science, but on the other hand, it's not scientific code as such. Because it's kind of the scientific code itself. I would actually say that as an RSE, you might have the job of optimizing it, but developing the scientific code is up to the scientist, kind of. Mm-hmm. The scientist should come up with the idea of a certain code. How to implement it, how to optimally implement it, that could be an RSE. Yeah. But the idea, the pseudocode algorithm, mm-hmm. well, a little bit more than the pure pseudo, that is up to the researcher.
Yeah. Okay. We're running short on time. So if there is someone who's just... it's a standard question I always ask. What do you know now that you wish someone had taught you when you first started your career as a scientist?
I think what this is now very much a different topic for me, because I at some point got the impression, okay, well, there are, I think in Finland it's less than in Germany, for example, but I once said to myself, well, if anyone asks me what I should do, I would say, well, if you want to get a, let's say, steady, reasonable income, have a life locally, probably rather look for some kind of apprenticeship or vocational school. Mm-hmm. While if you don't have any idea what you actually want with life, the studying route is at least has a much higher chance of giving you an overview of the world. So I after doing my undergraduates, I was essentially saying, I know nothing. I have no idea what I'm doing. I felt like, okay, I still need to learn so much. And even after finishing my PhD, I was like, okay, yeah, I have some idea about this field now. But I still don't know a lot. And if I would have started off essentially going to a kind of programming school or starting to become a programmer right after school, I would probably be in a decent living as well. The most steady jobs will probably still be some kind of carpentry that is always needed. Or, well, anything that's to do with plumbing, if you have the stomach for it.
Yeah. Okay, so now we're at the limit of our time right now. I guess we can keep asking questions, or answering and asking questions via HackMD, and we can return to this topic either in smaller discussions or in our next course. I think that this was a stimulating discussion and good for young people.